Most businesses start off by an entrepreneur making up things as he goes along. In most businesses, most of the way to do the business is in the mind of the entrepreneur. If the entrepreneur is not there, everything has to stop. And then businesses are run by the seat of their pants. But at a certain stage, you must decide exactly what is required in each area of your business and then write it down in a logical order so that someone else can do it. You can free yourself from the need to be involved in countless activities by creating a system for others to follow. It's also a tremendous discipline for you to organize on paper the various steps of the process. So look at your business as though you were an outside consultant trying to understand or explain the business to someone else. Even better, look at your business as though it were a franchise prototype. Imagine that you want to reproduce this business and sell it all over the world. Imagine you want to create 100 or 1,000 businesses like yours, so you have to systematize every single part of the business, like a McDonald's franchise where everything right down to the smallest French fry is organized, systematized, automatic, so that an average person with a limited education can do it correctly every single time. That's your goal for your business. Now, your job is to create a blueprint for your business so that it can be replicated many times over by other people and whether or not you're there. Now, here's one of the great rules, is a good business system is one that may have been developed by geniuses, but it can now be followed by morons. In other words, an average person should be able to run most of the functions of your business because they're all systematized. And that's what we'll talk about in this lesson. Now, the most important question in business is this, and it's a combination question that summarizes everything. It's exactly what is to be sold, and to whom is it to be sold, and by whom is it to be sold, and how is it to be sold, and at what price and terms is it to be sold, and how is your product going to be produced, paid for, delivered, and serviced? That is the great question. And so let's take each of those sub-questions in order. First question, exactly what is to be sold? To start off, to systematize your business, you list every product or service that you sell. And second of all, you determine the sales volume you expect from each product. You determine the exact cost of offering each product. Determine the cost of the product or service itself. Determine the cost of marketing and sales per unit. Determine the cost of administration and overhead per unit. Then you have to determine the cost of labor, including yours, per unit of each product or service you sell. Determine the cost of defects and returns and losses on sales. Determine the exact profit per unit after all of the above. You should know to the penny how much you make after everything at the end of the day from every product or service. Then make a list of every step necessary to create or procure the product for sale and delivery. Write out this list as a series of instructions, like a recipe, so that someone else can do it. You make this the first section of your operations manual. It should be so clear that if you were away for a month, other people could follow those instructions and produce and acquire and make your product or service available. The second question is, to whom is it to be sold? This is the great question in marketing research. This is a description of your ideal customer. So, what is the demographic profile of your ideal customer? That's age, education, income, background, position, profession, location, and so on. What is the psychographic profile of your ideal customer? Now, the psychographic profile deals with the wants, the needs, the desires, the fears, the tendencies, the hopes, the wishes, the psychology of your ideal customer. What is it in his or her mind that makes him or her ideal for what you sell? Then, once you have those, you ask, what are the benefits that your customer gets from your product? Remember this, customers don't buy products or services, they buy benefits, they buy results, they buy solutions to their problems. So what does your product do to change or improve the life or the work of your customer specifically? Now, what your customer wants, needs, expects, and demands are the key organizing principles of all of your marketing. And you and everyone else should know why customers and why ideal customers would buy from you rather than from someone else. Once you have this customer profile, which you continue to tweak as time passes, you explain it to everyone so that everyone in your business knows exactly who your customers are. They can identify them and they know exactly their hopes, desires, fears, backgrounds, age, education, income, and so on. Now the next question is, by whom is it to be sold? And this is really important. The people who meet and talk to your customers are the ones who sell the product. So who exactly is responsible for selling? It's an amazing thing that in companies, they start off and they have what is called role underlap, where you have this job description and this job description, but in the middle, like the space between two stools, critical functions are not assigned to a particular person. So you have to be very clear who exactly is responsible for selling and making the sale. The second question of this is, what exactly do they say to the customer? And this is very important because most salespeople make up what they say on a day-to-day, customer-to-customer basis. Most people say whatever falls out of their mouth, but not successful companies. What exactly do your salespeople say to the customer when he or she phones? Good companies have a script that they follow word for word. Hello, this is Susan. How are you today? How can I help you? In other words, it's word for word. And what do people say when someone inquires about what you sell? They come in to your place of business, they talk to your salespeople, they come to your website. What words do you use? Especially, what does your salesperson say when he calls on them outside of the office? What is the sales script, methodology, and process that salespeople use when they get face-to-face with a prospective customer? This is not something you can leave to chance. Now, here's an interesting discovery. You can triple your sales by systematizing your sales process. In other words, a systematized sales process yields three times the number of confirmed sales as a random process that people just make up each time they meet a customer. Your sales methodology to ensure maximum conversion rates is the core of your business. What you need to do is write it out word for word. You identify the areas of weakness in your sales methodology. You can continually edit it and improve the sales process. So the question is, what is your sales process? What is your step-by-step sales process? Each person who sells or deals with customers must be trained in what to do and say with customers. Now, here's a rule. You cannot expect a person to make a sale that he or she has not been trained for. I work and have worked with thousands of companies over the years, and I'm always astonished when I deal with a company that doesn't train their people. They give them what is called product training. They say, here's the products and here's the ingredients and here's the brochures and so on, but they don't train them in the methodology and process of greeting customers, building relationships, identifying needs, presenting the product so it matches the needs, answering objections, and closing the sale. And then they're surprised that their salespeople don't make many sales. You can't expect people to do anything in your business unless you have trained them for it and then watch them demonstrate that they are competent and proficient in doing it. Very important. Well, the best and most profitable companies have the best trained salespeople. The Fortune 500 companies that I work with will hire people out of top universities with top grades. They will train them for 6, 12, 18 months, and they'll put them into the field, and these people sell billions of dollars of product. Little companies with under-trained or non-trained salespeople do not have a chance against the professionals. Remember this, in your business, nothing happens until someone sells something to somebody. Nothing happens. Everything in your business is aimed at that point of making the sale. So here's the next question. How is it to be sold? And this describes the entire process of marketing, advertising, attracting customers, and finally, making the sale. You need a complete marketing plan for your business. You need to think it through in advance. Exactly what is the process of what we call customer acquisition? How do you acquire customers? How do you advertise to them, promote to them? How do you bring them into your sphere? What is the steps that you use? And you start by determining your core marketing message. Your core marketing message revolves around your unique selling proposition. Your unique proposition is the special reason why someone should buy from you rather than from anyone else. So, what is it about your product or service that makes it different, unique, special, superior, excellent in some way that no other company can offer. Whatever it is, that becomes the axle around which all of your marketing revolves. That becomes the core message, which is repeated in every single advertising piece of advertising or promotion. Well, the next thing you do is you determine the best way to reach your prospective customer. Remember the customer that we have identified who is the ideal customer. Where is this customer? How do you reach them? What do they read? What are they influenced by? And so on. Determine how you will advertise. Determine where you will advertise. And determine how much you will spend. Now, we've talked about this before, but in determining how much you will spend to advertise, you always have to ask, what is my cost of customer acquisition? How much am I willing to pay to acquire a customer? Remember, you have two people that you acquire in advertising. First is a lead. This is a person who is interested and will respond to your advertising. The second is the person who will buy, which will be a much smaller percentage of the people who initially respond. How much are you willing to spend to acquire customers? And what we do with our clients is we say this: if you could take a certain amount of money and go out in the street and give a certain number of dollars to a person to get them to come and buy from you, how much would you be willing to pay to get them to buy? Some companies will pay 50 cents on the dollar of sale. Companies will pay 10 cents. Some companies will say pay 5 cents. But how much are you willing to pay? And that determines how much you will spend in advertising. Now, once you start to advertise, you set standards to measure the effectiveness of your marketing efforts, especially advertising. In other words, you say we're going to spend this amount of money to acquire this amount of leads, which will translate into this number of customers, which will translate into this level of sales, which will translate into this level of profitability. And you set those standards before you advertise in the first place. Then you continually compare, is my advertising actually delivering the bottom line results that I projected when I began? Remember, 50% of all advertising is wasted because it's like water that splashes and doesn't get onto the customers because it's going in the wrong direction to the wrong customers with the wrong message. Once you have all these done, you write all these things down on paper in advance and you analyze them carefully. You require a complete sales process with pre-planned steps and scripts for each product and each step of the process. You need contracts and order forms and price lists and brochures and internet set design and everything else necessary to take the order once the sale has been made. And all those things have to be done in advance before you talk to your first customer. If you're already selling and you haven't done them, then you have to pull back quickly and design the entire sales process, including every single piece of paper that you need to make the sale. In one of my businesses, after we'd been operating for several years, I found that there was no standard order form. That when people phoned up and ordered, it was written down on a piece of paper, and then it was translated into another piece of paper, and then it was made into an order, and it was absolute confusion. So I said, why don't we have a standard order form? Well, you know, we've gotten used to using this old system, but once the order form has been standardized, you can take hundreds of orders and make hundreds of sales with absolute maximum efficiency. And this is very important for you to do. Now, the next question is, at what price and terms are you going to sell your product? How much are you going to charge? How are you going to charge it? And how are you going to require payment? This is very important. So determine your individual retail prices. Determine any discount or combination or special prices or for special reasons that you're willing to offer, and then decide upon your wholesale prices and large volume purchases so they're all written down. They're not made up when somebody calls and says, what if I buy 10? You've got a specific written standard that anyone can follow. Determine how much you are willing to pay or to discount to acquire a customer. Some companies will discount the product a lot rather than lose the customer altogether. So decide in advance so that this is not a discretionary thing that people make up when the question comes up. Another thing you need to do is estimate the lifetime value of each customer. If you acquire a customer, how much is he or she likely to spend with you in the future? And that's a major determinant of how much you can spend to get that customer in the first place. Now, this is a very sensitive issue. It's a very sensitive and complex area. So continue to revisit and be willing to reconsider your prices, especially in the face of declining sales. Sometimes because of competition, changes in the marketplace, changes in technology, you have to go back and revise your prices in a variety of different ways. And you have to do this all the time. Now, the next question in standardizing your business processes is, how is the product going to be produced? List every step from the beginning of the production process to the finished product. Explain it in such detail that someone else could do it with limited experience and ability. If you purchase products for resale, write out a step-by-step description of the process of acquisition and payment. In other words, where do you buy them from? Who do you talk to? What's the process of placing the order? What's the process of taking delivery? What's the process of payment? And so on. Now, here's an exercise. Imagine leaving for a month and hiring a temp to produce or acquire your products or services. If you were leaving for a month, you have to write out the instructions so that they are so simple and easily understood that an average person could do it competently in your absence. And by forcing yourself to do this, you become much more efficient in this part of your business. Now, the next question is, how is the product going to be delivered? Chart out every step of the delivery process. From the time the customer orders, what is the process by which they receive delivery of the product? Determine how long each step will take. Determine how much each step will cost. Identify the possible problem areas and take steps to guard against problems. And then document the entire process so that a child could do it. The final question is, how is the product to be serviced, repaired, or replaced? There will always be problems with products or services. People will send them back, will not like them, they will break, they'll need to be repaired, they'll need to be serviced, and so on. So set up a process to provide for breakage, returns, and dissatisfied customers. Set up a system so that everyone knows how to deal with it automatically when it comes up. Set up policies and procedures for each step. The greatest danger is when people make up how they're going to deal with a problem each time it comes up, rather than having a specific set of policies and procedures. Set up a return policy and a procedure. Let me give you an example. One of the things that we do with our products and services is we guarantee them for a year. We say, if you're not happy, you can send them back in a year. You have 12 months to decide. Well, sometimes a product will come back 14 or 15 months after we've sold it. And we say, well, what do we do with this? The answer is we return it to the client and we say, our return policy is very simple. You return it to us, you pay the postage, and we'll credit you back 100% of the cost within 12 months, not 14 or 15 months, or sometimes, well, we get an awful lot of returns come back in December. People are trying to free up money for Christmas presents, and so they'll send stuff that they don't have any receipts for, and they'll send it in, and the stuff may have been sold years before. So set up a return policy, and then stick to your return policy. And finally, once you have all this, document everything in your operations manual. Your operations manual should have every single step. Whenever you have a problem, by the way, or a breakdown or a blockage in your business, take action to assure it doesn't happen again. In business, you're going to have lots and lots of problems. What you have to do is you have to stop the clock and say, okay, this happened. It was unexpected. We didn't think this would happen. So what are we going to do about it? Now, if you have a recurring problem, like every month you have a problem with payment or payroll or delivery or shipment or with a supplier or something else, this is a sign of bad management. A recurring problem means that you have not put a solution in place, so therefore it just continually occurs. So when you have a problem of any kind, new or recurring, determine first of all exactly what has happened. Ask, what is the problem? What has happened here? And ask, how did it occur? Before you make any attempt to solve it, be clear about what it is and how it happened. Then you ask the question, what is the solution? What can we do to assure that this doesn't happen again? And then you decide, what do we do now? In other words, what step do we take immediately? How can we assure that this problem does not occur again? When you're dealing with problems, by the way, the most powerful words are the words, next time. Whenever you have a problem or a difficulty, you ask the question, what will we do next time? And this keeps everybody focused on the solution. It keeps everybody focused on the future. It keeps everybody focused creatively on what can be done. Now, your operations manual becomes your Bible for running your business. Every new business or business activity takes enormous efforts and expense to learn and standardize. It takes tremendous thought, but once you've created your business process and put in an operations manual, it can be carried out quickly and correctly by ordinary people. What this does is it then frees you more and more to do the creative thinking, planning, and marketing that enables your business to grow and grow and grow. An operations manual is the foundation of every successful business.